Hello and welcome to QCrypt Talk number 89. My name is Nitin Jain. I am from the Technical University of Denmark. This work was done in collaboration with University of Sheffield and University of York from the UK and the Austrian Institute of Technology. Before I begin my talk, I would like to thank the organizers of QCrypt for giving us the chance to present our results. And I would also like to thank the grant agencies for providing the funding for this work. Quantum key distribution, or QKD, is a method to obtain quantum correlations out of randomness. QKD users, typically called Alice and Bob, perform a sequence of steps which together form a QKD protocol. These are done over a pair of communication channels, the quantum channel and the authenticated channel. These channels are assumed to be in full control of an adversary, Eve, who also eavesdrops on the communication. Depending on the amount of her eavesdropping, Alice and Bob may be able to obtain a common bit string, out of which a secret key can then be distilled for use in cryptographic tasks, such as data encryption. Before we can use this common bit string as a secret key, there are several physical considerations to be taken into account. The first is about what capabilities does Eve possess? Does she possess quantum memory? What kind of unitary interactions is she allowed to perform on the quantum states from Alice to Bob? These are usually classified by the kind of attacks that Eve performs, and one usually uses the terms individual, collective, or coherent attack in increasing order of power. Another consideration, which is kind of obvious if one thinks about it, if the secret key with Alice and Bob is of length n bits, then Eve knows this key with a probability at least 2 to the power minus n. Of course, one can make n very large and then this probability becomes smaller, but the probability is never zero, which means that QKD systems can never provide unconditional security or absolute security. And the reason reason that n is not infinity is because of the limited number of channel uses that Alice and Bob can do. This leads to the so-called finite size corrections, which reduce the achievable secret key length, however are important for ensuring that the key is secret. Finally, composability is a framework that allows specifying the security requirements for combining different cryptographic applications in a unified and systematic way. In the context of practical QKD, composability is of utmost importance because the secret keys obtained from a QKD protocol are almost always used in other applications. A QKD protocol should be secure, meaning that the output keys should be identical and secret. These are related with the secrecy and correctness properties. It should also be robust. That is, it should output non-trivial keys if there is no active attack on the quantum channel. Those were some of the theoretical considerations that affect a secret key. From a practical point of view, the design and the operation of the QKD system has a direct or an indirect effect on the secret key length as well. Ours is a CVQKD system, in which the information is coded in continuous variable properties, and the best examples are the amplitude and the phase quadratures of the light field. These are usually denoted by X and P. Any CVQKD system is invariably a coherent communication system. That means that the transmitter and a receiver share a common phase reference, and this is done by providing a local oscillator. A CVQKD transmitter encodes random bits by means of modulation. As this diagram shows, this is typically done by a random number generator which drives a quadrature modulation setup. While all CVQKD receivers perform coherent detection, there are broadly three classes that we will discuss now. By using a phase modulator on the local oscillator, which changes the phase of the local oscillator by 0 or pi by 2, a CVQKD receiver can decode either the X or the P quadrature. This is called homodyne detection. One can also decode both X and P simultaneously by using two homodyne detections. In this case, the local oscillator phase of one arm is changed by a phase of pi by 2 with respect to the other. This may seem as if the information gets doubled. However, due to quantum mechanics, there is a penalty of extra noise in this architecture. This is known as phase diversity. There is yet another way to detect both quadratures simultaneously, and this is possible when the signal frequency and the local oscillator frequency do not match. This is known as heterodyne detection or a heterodyne receiver. There are many possible flavors of a CVQKD transmitter based on the nature of the optical source, the physical devices used for quadrature modulation, and a phase-based constellation that is ultimately produced. CVQKD systems typically use either pulsed or continuous wave lasers and modulate in sidebands. Recently, there also have been implementations with both pulsed and continuous wave in the same system, which can be called hybrid implementations. Traditionally, the transmitter employed separate amplitude and phase modulators for the purpose of quadrature modulation. However, in the last 5 years, IQ modulators, where I and Q are the classical equivalents of X and P, have also gained popularity. Finally, the most typical alphabet or the phase-based constellation is Gaussian modulation with coherent states. You can see an example of a state in this Gaussian modulation. This state is centered at X0 and P0, which are random symbols drawn from Gaussian discretized Gaussian probability distributions. It is also possible to employ squeezing for CVQKD by using EPR entangled states or squeezed vacuum states. Of late, there has been a shift to also try non-Gaussian phase-based constellations, for example, phase shift keying or quadrature amplitude modulation. On the receiver side, there are two possibilities for the local oscillator. CVQKD systems or CVQKD transmitters can send both the signal and the local oscillator on the quantum channel to the receiver. The obvious advantage of such a scheme, also called a transmitted LO scheme, is that the receiver has a stable relative phase. However, this comes at the cost of complicated multiplexing solutions, such as in time and in polarization. Furthermore, such schemes are vulnerable to intensity and wavelength manipulation on the quantum channel. And lastly, the intensity of the LO is limited both from a receiver and a transmitter point of view due to propagation losses in the quantum channel and nonlinear effects. The alternative is to use a real or a local oscillator. This leads to relatively simpler setups for the transmitter and receiver, and there is no limitation on the intensity of the local oscillator. The major drawback of this scheme is the tolerance on the phase noise of the lasers is quite low. One needs fairly complex phase reference alignment schemes in order to make these schemes work. Nonetheless, this is the correct scheme to follow because this is more secure. Okay, based on the features discussed in the last few slides, here you can see a table listing some CVQKD implementations from the last 10 years or 8 years. You can see there is no column that discusses the type of attack from Eve, which is because all these works considered security against collective attacks. The first is the 2013 work from the Paris group, where they demonstrated CVQKD exchange of keys using CVQKD over 80.5 kilometer long channel. In 2015, at Oak Ridge National Laboratory, the first real local oscillator-based CVQKD implementation was demonstrated. This used a phase-diverse coherent receiver. In the same year, in the group of Roman Schnabel, another CVQKD implementation that used entangled states, EPR states that is, was demonstrated. A unique feature of this implementation, as you can see in this last column, is that this is the only one that could produce composable key. In the group of Christian Schaefer from Hamburg, the CVQKD implementation demonstrated by Kleiss et al. Was the first to use frequency multiplex pilot tones instead of reference pulses and heterodyne detection. In the group at Austrian Institute of Technology, Laudenbach et al. Also did a demonstration with a very high bandwidth of 250 megahertz, and their coherent detection was intradyne, which is similar to heterodyne, except that the difference of the signal and local oscillator frequencies is close to zero. Finally, last year, we had the first CVQKD implementation that surpassed not only 100 but 200 kilometers. This brings me to the motivation behind our work. So far, there has been only one composable secure CVQKD implementation. However, this required production of squeeze states, which is difficult in practice. Furthermore, the achieved distance was rather small, which is because the security proof employed an entropic uncertainty principle, which does not have very tight bounds. So the question we asked ourselves was, is there the possibility of Gaussian modulated coherent state CVQKD implementation producing composable keys? On the lighter side, the coherent states are quite easy to produce and broadband high-speed modulation is pretty well investigated. Also, a security proof for composable CVQKD employing Gaussian modulation and heterodyne detection or double homodyne detection has been available since 2015. However, this has a rather strict security bound and requires a large number of quantum states. From an experimental point of view, this translates into long acquisition times, which is not so good for the stability of the system. Also, the parameter estimation routine in the security proof is rather complicated. So with this, I will switch gears and describe the implementation, the CVQKD implementation we have made in our lab. It uses polarization maintaining fibers in the transmitter and receiver and an IQ modulator for quadrature modulation. The first step is to produce the quantum random number generators, quantum random numbers, which is done using a vacuum fluctuation based homodyne detection and randomness extraction using an FPGA. This gives us uniformly distributed random numbers, which are then converted to Gaussian distribution for the purpose of modulation. Then with some digital signal processing, these symbols are converted into waveforms that are then applied onto the IQ modulator using an arbitrary waveform generator. The IQ modulator operates in the so-called optical single sideband modulation regime, which is possible by using automatic bias control. Finally, the quantum states coming out of the IQ modulator are suitably attenuated to be on the quantum level. The quantum channel in our implementation is 20 km long and made of single mode fiber. After propagating on the quantum channel, the quantum states arrive at the receiver. The quantum signal arrives at the receiver, where a polarization controller is used to match its polarization with that of the real local oscillator. We perform heterodyne detection, and the output of the heterodyne detector is captured by an analog to digital converter. After the acquisition, we perform demodulation of this data. Here is a diagram showing the entire protocol in action. The state preparation and the state measurement are done using n symbols or quantum states. Then the classical steps using the authenticated channel are information reconciliation, parameter estimation, and privacy amplification. And in this last step, we have some n symbols that provide us uniform shared randomness. And finally, at the end of the privacy amplification step, we get keys that are m bits long. These are secret composable keys. Here are a few details about the implementation. As mentioned already, we do optical single sideband modulation using an IQ modulator in the transmitter. The Gaussian modulated quantum symbols are produced in a sideband which is 100 MHz wide. So this is the effective speed of our system. and we multiplex a pilot tone at 25 MHz for phase recovery, which is shown here in the spectra. At the receiver, we perform heterodyne detection with the real local oscillator using a fast analog to digital converter with 16-bit resolution and 1 gigasamples sampling rate. Here you can see the spectra from the heterodyne the output of the heterodyne detector. And finally, during demodulation, we use a machine learning framework for carrier phase recovery and quantum symbol reconstruction. Here are the results. The black squares, what you see is the untrusted noise in millishot noise units as a function of the number of complex symbols that were acquired and demodulated. The black squares show the measured untrusted noise, while the red and the blue traces are the threshold for null secret key fraction, that is the untrusted noise at which the secret key fraction would go to zero. So to summarize, the quantum symbols are produced at a rate of 100 megabaud. The modulation variance is optimized earlier in a back-to-back measurement at around 2.9. We exchange around 10 to the power 9 quantum symbols. In separate measurements, we calibrate the receiver and get the trusted efficiency and the trusted noise as 0.689 and 0.051 in short noise units, respectively. In the channel measurement, at the end, when we do parameter estimation, we obtain our untrusted efficiency of 0.354 and an untrusted excess noise of 12 millishot noise units averaged over the 10 to the power 9 symbols. In the information reconciliation step, we use a code with a rate of 0.19. The frame error rate is quite low, almost negligible. However, the reconciliation efficiency is not too high, yet it allows us to generate a secret key, and the leakage is 1.6 gigabits in this process. In the secret key calculation, we have a uniform shared randomness from a little less than 10 power 9 symbols, and we use security parameters for calibration, hashing, smoothing, and parameter estimation of around 10 to the power minus 10. With this, we end up with a secret key which is 30.92 megabits long. This result is possible because of theoretical improvements in the security proof, which I'm going to discuss now. Namely, Eve's Holivaux information is estimated by evaluating the covariance matrix, a simplified version of which can be seen here. The worst case estimates from this covariance matrix entries are based on confidence intervals. What we did was to use a different distribution called a beta distribution, which allowed us to obtain tighter confidence in intervals. And these can be these are illustrated in these two graphs. On the y-axis, you have the confidence on the covariance matrix entry y, and here you have the same on z. Using the original proof, we get a trace like this, but using the beta distribution, one can see that the confidence interval is tighter. If we further assume that the underlying data was Gaussian, then even better confidence intervals are possible. With that, I would like to conclude this talk. So we have demonstrated a Gaussian modulated coherent state CVQKD protocol implementation over a 20 kilometer long quantum channel. This provides security against collective attacks, takes finite size effects into account, and is able to produce a composable secret key with just 300 million quantum symbols. And with around 10 to the power 12 quantum symbols, we estimate that it would be within 1% of the asymptotic value. And this is an order of magnitude better than the 2015 security proof. As an outlook, we are now working on an autonomous CVQKD implementation over a realistic channel. And one of the main elements for this is to do clock recovery. For this, I can recommend the poster by my colleague Homan Chin. And we also need to improve our information reconciliation to get a higher reconciliation efficiency. With that, I would like to thank you for your attention. Bye.